morning, everyone. Thanks for tuning in to another The Next Level Live. Let's get started with those numbers. In October week three, we hit 7,994,000, which brings our October monthly in volume at 28,693,000, and our 2023 year-to-date in volume at 407,225,000. Let's jump right into our agent recognition this morning. This week, our agent spotlight featured Desiree Bloss with FFL Prim Group. Desiree helped 17 families in just 1 week. Great work, Desiree. Our then versus now featured Katie Carmody with FFL Metamorphosis. Katie has helped 500 families year to date. Congratulations, Katie. We have 7 members to induct into our Personal Production Hall of Fame this morning. A big congrats to first-timer William Tomlinson with FFL Mentality. Congrats second-timer David Pania with FFL Disciples. Congrats second-timer Zebulon Foster with FFL Yellowstone. Big congrats to Paul Smith, second-timer with FFL Associates. Congrats second-timer Daniel Gaines with FFL Trident Life. Big congrats to fourth-timer Jack Yu with FFL Financial. And big congrats to first-timer Saman Namavi with FFL Universe. Coming up next, we've got our pressure point and inside the sale with Alex Valencia. Enjoy the training.
All right, guys, welcome to Pressure Point, and more importantly, another episode of Next Level Live. What I want to talk to you today is about that, trainings. One of the things that I did when I got in any industry, real estate, I got a hold of every training I could. Life insurance, every training I could. When I got into general contracting, that was a long time ago. There was not a library of trainings. And it took me a lot longer to get ahead because I had to go find the people and get the information from them. I had to go to the job sites, observe, watch, and actually just do it. So we're in an industry nowadays, first of all, with everything on social media, everything on the internet, everything on YouTube, you can go ahead and find about anything out about anything you want to, right? Is you starting to understand, how do I do that? How can I take that and translate it and make that better for me? So let's, the Next Level Live, for instance, you'll find how many thousands of downloads we get after the weekend. And it'll always make me laugh when somebody says, I'm not having success in the business. What's your advice? I go, hey, what's the Next Level Live in the last 4 weeks you've liked the most? And they go, what do you mean? I go, no, I mean, you're not having success in the business. I just want to be able to talk to you intelligently about what you're taking in for information. What is the TNL you've liked the best over the last 4 weeks? Crickets, nothing. Because they have nothing to say. I go, all right, well, how about the base shop builders call? Mondays, give me the best one. I'm trying to build a business, Sean. I'm really struggling with it. Give me the one that you've liked the best. Who was the base shop builders call you enjoyed the most? Crickets, because they have nothing to say. And I'm like, okay, so you won't get on the calls. Okay, well, you're trying to help become more profitable. That makes sense. What's been the best SRS training you've heard so far? We do those during the week as well. Crickets. I'm going to give 3 shots to be trained for free, like real time by people in your industry that are having success, and you pass on all 3. Now, the thing is, when I'm working with somebody, if that's the case, I start with just go to get the trainings, then we'll talk about it as you start being trained. I don't do very well with somebody that wants to skip all the training and make me be all things to them. I'm not going to do it. That's a bad return on my investment, bad return on my time. So I applaud you for getting on today because this is the key to your success. When I got my life insurance license in 08, I said I'm going to plug into trainings more than anybody else and I'm going to outwork everybody. And I became number one person at that company by far. And then when we launched Fan First Life, I'm like, I'm going to plug into more trainings, get better at what I'm trying to do and building a business, get around more people, get mentored, that whole deal. You're in a business now where all the information at your fingertips. You have a team. Why would you answer all their questions when they won't take any time out of their day to get on the trainings? And if you are trying to be all things to your team, like you're the only good one in the entire industry, be careful, dude. Number one, you're not right. Number two, that's a lot of work if you were right. That means the only person that can train them is you. And that narcissism and egoism is going to cripple you. So I applaud y'all for not being egotistical. I applaud you for being transparent, open to training. Thank you for getting on today. That's my pressure point of the day. Find people like you that are willing to be trained, that are vulnerable. I was 36 on my insurance license, and I knew how to make money. I'd already made money in real estate. I wasn't like flat broke, but I had a lot of big bills. But I was very open to getting better because I knew that I could only have a big ego or a big business. You can't have both. And I'm like, cool, get rid of the ego. I want a big business. So, and I hope you do too. Since you're on today, you probably do. Now on to our T&L and our free training that you can get a lot out of. So thanks, guys.
Hey guys, welcome to Inside the Sale. We got a special guest in the house today, my man Alex Valencia. How are we doing, Alex?
Good, I'm good. Thank you very much for having me here today.
Absolutely, dude. Thanks for coming in. Thanks for joining us.
Pleasure.
So we're going to talk about some sales stuff today, Inside the Sale. And you, Alex, you are, right now, you're solely remote.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
Mortgage protection predominantly.
Yes.
And remote, you're doing a mix of virtual and telesales.
Correct.
But really, virtual is where you want to be.
That's where we start, and if we can't, we go to
you go to telesales. Yeah. What percentage of your appointments are you would be virtual?
Any given week, anywhere between 60 to 65%.
Okay.
Are virtual only because they can't do it Zoom.
Got it.
But we're aiming towards Zoom.
Yeah. So virtual. You're shooting for that, and if they can't for some reason, then you go telesales.
Correct.
And you're doing predominantly mortgage protection.
All right? of it.
All 100%. Mortgage protection.
100%.
So what we're going to talk about today is the mortgage protection remote sale.
Okay.
We talk a lot about final expense, especially with telesales. You know, an older demographic, sometimes it's harder to get them on Zoom. Sometimes they just want to be on the phone. But, you know, you're gearing them up for virtual. That's your deal. You did do some in-home prior to this, right?
Yes. Yeah. Start off with a couple.
Okay.
That lasted maybe 3-4 weeks.
Got it.
And the virtual is just that much better.
Yeah. Got it. And you came from a background. You were in stocks, commodities, where everything was on the phone anyway.
Yeah, that so was, yeah.
It's kind of easy fit sure. for you. Got it. And the reason why Alex is in this chair is, you know, he helps a lot of families. Right now, I don't know if you noticed, you're number 31 overall with us.
Okay.
Now, you go, well, that's 31. That doesn't seem the high. Yeah, but that's out of, Alex, there's well over 50,000 active agents. Now, active just means you have a license, you wrote a policy within the last 12 months with us. In a week, there's about 6,000 or more agents that put pen to paper.
Okay.
So of a pool of about 6,000, you're number 31.
Nice.
Not too bad. Helped over 500 families so far this year. Why I tell you that, it means he's qualified to sit in his chair and talk about sales. That's the only reason I tell you that, because we're not one of those companies where we have the guy who used to sell 10 years ago, and they come on here and they talk about sales.
Sure.
That was the case of just being me. I'm like, so back in my day, yeah. which we're not going to do.
Right, right.
So virtual mortgage protection. Talk to me a little bit about what are some keys to making that sale from the beginning. Obviously, there's some rapport you have to build, right? And you did a piece on our True Talk recently where you talked about specifically how you're getting them to trust you. Because that's sure. a big piece to any sale, right? Yep. And I think that I only sold face-to-face. I never did virtual telesales. But I knew looking at you face-to-face, reading your body language, watching the way you're not, I could tell whether you trusted me. I could watch your body cues, body language for little signals of like, oh, wait, maybe he didn't like that I said that. Maybe this is too, you know what I mean? It's very, now, talk to me about how you're doing that virtually. You can still see him, but it's a little bit of a disconnect.
Right? Sure, sure. So, yeah, the first thing is basically establishing credibility.
Yeah.
So the first thing that I do is I immediately after I introduce myself, I am glad I'm having a chance to sit with you today. I go right into the licenses.
Yeah.
So right before I call them or I'm on Zoom, I send them a text with my state license. So yeah. I actually download the license itself.
Okay.
Some of them are in color, but most of them are black and white, like that certificate.
Yeah.
Right? Crop it. Now have it in my phone, all the different states that I'm doing. And the other one, I have a badge. And I think FFL creates a badge.
Even, yeah.
But I had it independently done where it has a picture of myself, the national producer number on it right above it, above my name. And, you know, some of the different insurance carriers that I work with. And I send that out right before I do the appointment. So I'll send something like, hello, this is Alex. No, hello, John and Mary, let's say. It's Alexander Valencia, a senior state underwriter for the state of North Carolina, let's say.
Yeah.
I just finished my last appointment, and I should be on Zoom in the next 5 to 10 minutes as, you know, scheduled. In the meantime, please scroll up for my credentials. Boom, and it's right there.
Yeah.
Okay? So now they have that. And So when I get on Zoom, the first thing I say, well, as you know, I'm Alex Valencia. Pleased to meet you. I'm glad I'm having a chance to sit with both of you today. Before I get started, boom, I go right to those credentials.
Yeah.
And I'll say something to, did you have a chance to look at my credentials? I said, yeah, okay. So what you have there is my state certificate as well as my national producer number. I want you to have that for your records. The reason we send that out is since we do handle sensitive client information, bank account information, social security numbers. Now, what did I just do? Mm-hmm. Now they know I'm going to ask for that.
Right. You're removing the objection.
It's there.
It ever gets
there. Right there. Yep. Okay. So, you know, the state requires us to provide our credentials for your records. That way you know that you're speaking to a licensed field underwriter, not just a random person off the street. In fact, in order for me to do what I do, just to have this conversation with you, I had to go through an extensive FBI background check and fingerprinting in order as a requirement for the license. So I've been fully vetted by everybody, the federal government, state government, as well as the individual insurance carriers that I'm partnered with. And this is all for your protection. And I literally, for your protection, and I stop. Every time. I really appreciate that.
Yeah.
I say, hopefully you could appreciate that. Oh, yes, we do. And you could tell. Some of them even go, oh, thank you so much for doing that. And I say, yeah. Look, if I was on the other end of this phone, I'd want the same thing. You never know who you're speaking
to. Puts them at ease.
Completely at ease. And I mean, it's not one sentence. I mean, I went boom, boom, right. Boom, boom, boom. And so right there, I've never to this day, you know, truth be, I don't get an objection when it comes to that.
Yeah.
And I've shared that with some of the people on our team, and they thank me. Weeks later, look, I was having so many issues about credibility, it's gone.
Yeah.
You know, so again, send the text, explain to them what it is, why, and then boom, you move on from there. And you have a serious tone to yourself. Mm-hmm. So you're not coming across like a salesperson. You're coming across like a person, you know, who's trying to show them the credentials, you know.
Right.
It's very important. Tonality and how you do that is important as well.
Yeah.
And then, so I'm not spending a couple of minutes trying to get to know them. I'm just doing that. And then I go and I confirm the information on the actual file to verify all the information. I get it recorded.
Yeah.
I said, you know, for quality purposes, I'm going to go ahead and record. I'm going to basically confirm the information that I have here. This is for your protection and to ensure that we're properly servicing you. You know, so I have it recorded because it's good. So I get permission from them. And then I go through all the information on there. So right away, we're establishing that this is a serious call.
Right.
Right. And then right after that, I hit them with, now before I get started, I just want you to know that this is not a sales call. I'm not a salesperson. There's no transactions taking place. So this is not a pitch because there is no transactions taking place. All right. Yep. And then I go right into who I am. So that right there, it's got the credentials out of the way, which everyone's, who am I speaking to? And am I being sold?
Yep.
You just took away two major problems that people come into these meetings with. And so I've always said that the key to being successful in this type of business is to create a positive buying atmosphere. And so by eliminating who you are your licenses, and everything else, and you're not hiding it, you're telling them, I handle social security numbers, bank account numbers, so here's why I'm giving you this information. Mm-hmm. Pretty much saying, if you have a problem with that, we have a problem, we can't go forward.
Right.
So it takes it out right there.
Yeah, and it sets the expectation for later.
Absolutely. And I don't have issues getting, now, knock on wood, but I don't have issues getting bank account numbers, social security numbers, because I established that right from the beginning.
Yeah, that's awesome. Now, your appointments, you're dialing, setting appointments, and then meeting, or are you doing one-time closes?
I have a booker.
Okay.
Yeah, so they set up the appointments for me, one person.
Yeah.
And so it's being set up from one day to the next, no more than 24 hours in advance. Okay.
Got it.
And I love sometimes that. In the morning, too.
Yeah. Okay. And you said you run how many a day? 10, 15?
Right now, it's about, I was doing a little bit more, but right now, it's about 12.
About 12
appointments a day.
And of those 12 you have set up, how many are actually there when you show up?
About half.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Which
is some days are a little more, some days are not, you know. But if you average out a week, I would say, okay, so let me take that back to be more accurate. I know I speak to about 4 to 5 people a day. Sometimes I have to reschedule because I don't meet with them.
Right.
But they were ready.
Oh, okay.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because I'm, you know.
And how are you booking them? An hour apart, half hour?
45 minutes to 50 minutes apart.
Yeah.
I figure by 45 minutes into it, a little bit less, I know if I'm going to stay with them or not.
Yeah. Got it. That's a big piece right there, because you know, I remember being in home and wasting time in appointment. You're like, wasting time. When I know that all the red flags are there.
Yeah.
You have no interest in this. I screwed it up somehow. Whatever the case may be, but I know it's going nowhere. But I think sometimes, especially when we're new, we're so naive and we just want to, like, oh, I think I may have a deal. And you stay in that house for damn near 3 hours and you miss three other appointments and you help nobody, right? Yeah. So what you said is like knowing when to let it go, because there are some times, I understand they filled out a form, they filled out a lead, they reached out in some way, shape, or form, they spoke to the person dialing, they booked the appointment, they're there when you're on, they go through all this, but there are some clients that you're not going to be able to help for whatever the reason may be.
Sure.
Now, if that percentage is, you know, I'd say about 30% tops, I don't think it, like, if it's half, we got a problem, right? If you're meeting with people and half them not doing it, then there's something wrong.
Yeah, something's wrong, yeah.
Now, what are some signals, Alex? How are you, like, when do you know, how far into the appointment do you know that, yes, if things keep going the way they are, I should be able to help this family, or this thing's leading to a disaster, let me just put a stop to it.
So really good question, actually, and I experienced a lot of it this week. So there are different levels to that. The first level is when they're there, but they're not there.
Mm.
You know, and that's just complete disrespectful to me.
Yeah.
You know, so I'll say nice things to get them to engage. But if they're still not engaging, and then I pretty much tell them, look, this isn't something that you're interested in.
Yeah.
You know, because they'll sit there, they're do this kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I'm like, hello. You know, I'm sorry.
Paying attention.
Yeah. The kids are running around or something. And I'll say something like, look, you know, I take seriously what I do here. I take a lot of time out of my day to make sure that we're going to provide you the best service. And in order for me to do that, I need your attention, all of it.
Yeah.
And so if this is not a good time, I'll be more than happy to reschedule. You know, kind of do that. Because you get some people that claim they do, and then they're giving you the quick, kind of, but not. And so right away, those I try to reschedule or give them another shot to get it done. Because I could tell at that point that do you have something to send me in the mail kind of thing is coming, because they're not paying attention.
Right.
You know, and that's their way of kind of getting themselves out of committing.
Yeah.
And the reality is they're just not paying attention.
So those ones you're not writing off completely, but you're like, it's not going good today.
You're right.
Let me almost give them an out. Like, do you want to reschedule this? Now, absolutely. How many of those do that you get rescheduled, do you actually end up helping?
Very little.
Very little, yeah.
Yeah, but at least I didn't waste my time.
Exactly. Yeah, how far into the appointment are you usually making that decision?
That's probably a good 10 minutes.
Okay.
Because I could tell
they're not
paying attention.
Right. So move past that. That one, I mean, that was pretty simple. They're not paying attention. They're not involved. They're watching the kid. They're walking the dog. They're watching the Kardashians in the background. They're doing something.
There's a lot of activity going on. And one of the things I tell my booker, and I would basically say the same thing when I'm booking the appointment, a couple of things in order to expedite this appointment and make sure it goes well, and I give you the necessary policies or covers that you need. A couple things I'm going to ask of you. Number one, have your medication ready.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. Number two, I need your undivided attention. I don't want you doing yoga or preparing dinner or nothing like that. I need you sitting down with a pen and paper.
Your dialer saying all that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because if they don't do that, I mean, look, a lot of people do that. They're all full in. They still don't write a policy.
Sure.
So imagine the person's not doing that.
Right. Yeah.
So, and I'm a stickler with that because, you know, what we do, a lot of people get in sales because they failed at something else.
Mm.
What we do is an art. If you do it the right way and you're helping people and you're passionate about what you're doing, you're truly interested in helping them, doing a needs analysis, et cetera, you need their undivided attention.
Yeah, yeah.
So if I see them driving a car, I said, my apologies. And I know my booker tells them not to do that. I said, my apologies. I'll take responsibility for that. When could reschedule? Well, what do you mean? You're driving.
Yeah.
Number one, I'm not going to speak to you while you're driving. I'm not taking that responsibility in case you get in town. Well, I'll pull over. No. I need you at home, pen and paper, ready to take notes.
Yeah.
You know, so that's, I have to establish control right then and there.
Yeah, that's huge. And, you know, I hear that, and I know that there's agents that are listening, and then they go, you know, but listen, I wrote the guy in the car one time. And it's like, it's kind of like when I was in the field, Alex, I only wanted to sit at the dining room table.
That's it.
Did I, on occasion, write I wrote an application on the hood of my car at Burger King.
Sure.
You know, I've written inside of fast food restaurants.
But that's the exception. Yes. That's not the method.
Exactly. But I still do. There's plenty of times where I walk in, they sit down at the couch, and I'll go out, shake my man's hand, and almost like, can we just, let's
over
go
here.
Yeah. Or I'll just walk over to the table. You know what would always work for me was just play stupid. I act like I don't see him there at the couch.
Right, and you go right to
where's your kitchen table? Yeah. Just like I'm lost, you know?
You're creating a buying atmosphere.
Yeah.
I've written one, too, in the car.
Sure.
It's the extreme exception.
Yep.
You don't build a business by doing that.
Right.
That's not how you build a business.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So you're going to cut it off. Nope. Okay. We're not going to talk in the car. So, again, that one's pretty simple. As you get further into this appointment, where are some other signs?
So right when I verify all the information, the next thing I said, okay, so just so I become familiar with your case, you know, talk to me a little bit about your interest in the mortgage protection. What made you want to sit with me today? God forbid something happens to you in your absence. What's going on in your life right now? And then I look for feedback.
Yeah.
Well, and they say something, well, here's a simple look. I'm the main breadwinner. God forbid something happens. I need to make sure that my wife has a house, you know, a roof over her head.
Yeah.
Boom, enough.
Yeah.
I know that's an interest.
Yep.
So when I go into
it.
Right. Another common one, everyone's going to light up and says, yeah, but a lot of people say, I don't know why I'm here. The thing told me to set up an appointment.
Mm.
I said, okay, not a problem. I hear that, you know, once in a while. But here's what this is. And I explain what mortgage protection does. I said, there's two insurances they make you get. One of them is PMI, prime mortgage insurance, if you didn't put enough down. That protects the mortgage company, not you.
Right.
The other insurance they ask you is homeowners. That protects the home, not you. This is the only one that protects you. Okay, so this is about, God forbid, something happens to you, depending on what you could qualify for, has living benefits associated with it, death benefit. So we want to first establish that the bank doesn't take the home. Second thing is, what can you qualify for that actually pay off the mortgage or at least buy some time for the person that's left behind to figure out what their next move is? And so when I go down that, I said, do you understand now? Is that something you want to look into? Yes. Okay. And I keep going.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they got to show me enough of an interest at that point.
Right.
And in many times, you know, which is going to go contrary, they say, well, no, we're fine. I said, okay, you're fine. I said, who's the main breadwinner? Okay. Now, if he passes away, can you live in that house by yourself? And sometimes they were good. I said, okay. And I do some math. And when I do the math, they're not good.
Right.
So right there, I kind of have to go to the qualifying part a little bit. I said, let me ask you, what kind of income do you have? What about yours? Okay, so he's gone now. His 4,000 is gone. You're living off 1,500. What now? What happens now?
Yeah.
Okay. So show us a little bit of what you have. So sometimes you got to do that.
Yeah, that's huge because, you know, we're talking about some situations where we know it's not a deal, right? But that's not one of them. That's your stereotypical objection. I mean, think about, like, you went in the store, bought that shirt most likely. Maybe you went to Under Armour store. You probably knew you wanted a black polo. But if the guy came over to you, Alex, said, can I help you today, sir? What did you say most likely?
I'm just looking.
You're not looking. Yeah, I'm just looking.
Right.
You're not just looking. Wanted to buy a black polo.
Right.
You knew the size. You knew you wanted a black one.
You got to ask questions.
Right. Yep.
Ask questions.
But that's, we're all conditioned to not be sold, right? I mean, dude, I remember being on a car lot with my dad and like, where are we going? We're looking at cars. We're buying one? No. And when a salesman came out, no, I'm just looking. I'm like, why are we here then? You know? But that's human nature. So when you hear that, that's not a pack it up and go home or close your laptop. Ask some more questions.
Ask some more questions. Put them in that situation.
Absolutely.
So I'll even introduce it like, all right, just to make sure I did my job, okay? Mm-hmm. I'm just going to ask a couple of quick questions just to make sure. Because honestly, 9 out of 10 times people tell me that, and they're not. So Maybe you're that 1 out of 10. Let's see. And I ask a couple of quick questions. I'm like, this is just basic math. It's not there.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so let me ask a couple of medical questions, see what you could qualify for. Boom.
And that's another part that's key is you're not waiting for their permission to move forward.
Like, no.
They gave you permission when they filled out the form. They gave you permission when they were there for your appointment. They gave you permission all along the way.
Yeah, there's an old Italian proverb that says, he who asks timidly invites refusal.
Mm.
So I don't ask for a pen and paper. A lot of people say, do you have a pen and paper handy? No. I say, do me a favor, grab a pen and paper. I'll hold on. Tell me when you're ready.
Yeah.
That's a command. That's not a question.
Dude, everyone has a pen and paper somewhere.
Everyone. And if you don't, if you ask if they have it, they're going to say no. Now what? Where do you go with that?
That's the thing. People normally are going to give you the opposite. It's like if you ask if it's a good time, no.
No.
Is it a bad time? Most of the time they're going to say no. Yeah. Right? Like small, simple things like that.
Yeah.
Very. Small little perspective
change. And it establishes control.
Yes.
You're not asking permission. You're telling them.
Right.
When you tell someone to grab a pen and paper and they do it, what did you just do? You just elevated yourself, you know, to a different level.
Which then follows you along your entire process, right? I'm not going, do you mind giving me your social? I go, what's your social? Just like that.
Just like that.
Once I started asking it like that, I never got issues.
Right.
When I would go, they need your social security number now, sir.
Tonality.
Like, God, you might as well just like, you might as well tell them you're committing fraud. Like, it sounds like you are.
Yeah.
You know, but if I just go, hey, which social? You need my social? Yeah, they needed to verify you are. You say you are. What is it?
Right,
like, exactly. It's just like, it's me asking you what your dog's name is.
Yeah, yeah. It's when your tone is unsure if that's a question or a statement.
Right.
You know, can I get your soul? Is that a question or a statement? You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's like, you're making me nervous now. You're
it's posture. It's all posture.
100%. Yeah. 100%. So, but that's key is like you, once they've said that, you know, once they've established that you don't have enough money, if your husband dies or vice versa, you're then going, okay, cool, let's see what we can qualify you for. Right. Not like, is it okay to move on now?
No.
And those are small things that make a big difference.
What I've noticed, and what you just said is key, when people are not doing well, it's literally a 1 to 2 degree change,
right,
and all of a sudden, everything just falls in place.
I agree. It's not an overhaul.
No, it's small, little, tiny things like that.
Yeah.
You know, that's why you got to pay attention to the details.
Right. It's why agents say things like, I'm saying exactly what you're saying, Alex, and I'm getting that. Because you're right. It's not a mass. You're saying pretty much what he's saying.
Right.
But there's these small little things that you're not doing. And it's usually the control. It's usually the assertiveness.
It's story, storyteller.
Yes.
Huge difference. Mm-hmm. Same story, different storyteller.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
What else? Moving through the appointment, any other signs of, yes, this is this is going in the right direction, or no, this is not?
Okay, so once we go through the medical questions, I could pretty much, you get with the way that the structure is, you could help out almost everybody.
Yeah.
So that doesn't do anything there.
Yeah.
When you start going to the financial numbers,
yeah,
that's when you want to just kind of move on. If it's not there. So you have people that have tons of money.
Yeah.
Tons of insurance. And once they have all that in place, it's time to move.
Mm.
You know, I you know, there are different programs as far as trying to sell the insurance part of it.
Yeah, yeah.
But there are different programs then that you could open up to different conversations with annuities or whatever it may be. But, you know, and that's a rare exception, though,
sure,
by the way.
Sure.
Refusing to give a lot of information out. Why do you need that for? That kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. I said, in order for me to help you, you have to help me. I need this information in order to be able to help you, you know. But I just don't get that.
Yeah.
So if I could get past those first couple of parts there and get to the medical questions and the financial numbers, you know, I'm pretty much good at that point.
So your goal, once you're there, you know that there's a really slim chance that this is going to fall off the rails at this point.
Right, right.
But you've done enough on the front end.
I've done enough there to get to, if I'm at that point, I'm not wasting my time.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean they're going to buy, but I'm not wasting my time.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I do a lot of what is like upside down pyramid selling.
Okay.
I hate the word using sell, but it's more making sure you establish everything up top so you're not trying to sell them at the bottom.
Right.
So by putting in the right things up top, you're not closing. You're not selling.
Yeah.
You're giving them options or choosing an option, but you don't have to sit there and sell them.
Sure.
Because you've established that in the beginning.
And what you're doing there, I like how you put that upside down pyramid, but you're removing all the objections.
Immediately.
Your goal is to not overcome objections.
Right. I don't have rebuttals written down.
No.
Honest to God, I don't.
You shouldn't.
Because if you take care of everything up top and make sure that they're paying attention, you're not going to have them at the end.
You remove like 5 or 6, probably a dozen objections just with your opening of here's who I am, here's my credentials, here's why I'm doing it. The state makes me, I got to go through this arduous process to even be licensed, which is all true, by the
way. It's all true.
And it's like I could start the same appointment and say none of that. I have the same license you have, but I'm not explaining it properly. And then I go, "What? I did exactly what you did. No, you didn't, dude.
No, you didn't.
You went above and beyond to make this, you know, it's like you almost did it backwards from how we used to do the in-home stuff. Because the in-home, we'd go in, and I'd want to connect with you first. Hey, man, nice house, nice shirt. You like unarmored? Like, whatever it may be.
Anything.
Yeah. And then I go, okay, guys, here's what we're here for today.
Yeah.
But you're hitting them right off the top with this, and it's different because, I mean, – the thing about the in-home, there's more leeway there. I'm in your house. What are you going to do, pick me up and throw me out the door? I'm 260 pounds. Good luck.
Yeah, yeah. It's
not on the phone, or you just shut the laptop.
Right.
Okay, call's over.
Yep.
You know, they hit the red button, dude. Call's over.
Yep.
There's a lot less room for error there than in the, I can come back from some screw-ups in the home.
Yeah.
You know, you got to be on it on the phone.
And I learned that because I used to want to establish rapport.
Yeah.
And I learned that. You gotta get to a certain point or else they lose interest. So you establish rapport as you go along.
Right. So did you try to do it in the beginning?
Yeah, it was just taking too long.
Yeah.
Two and a half, 3 hours.
Wow.
It's too long. Now it's about an hour.
Yeah. So your phone call, your virtual appointment is done in an hour now.
It's an hour and 15. If it's a couple with a lot of questions, a lot of medical conditions, it could be a little bit longer.
Yeah.
You know, and then depending on how good they are with the application.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I hear people say 45 minutes. I'm like, I'm sorry, but you're lying. Because it's no.
Yeah.
You know, and unless they're like, here, I want insurance.
Right. Which, yeah, hey.
And you're at speed typing
exactly.
Or something.
You'll get a few of those here and there.
Yeah.
You know? But for the most part, you know, I always talk about this on our training. There's where you make your money here is that percentage of the clients that need to be kind of pushed a little bit, right? There's a percentage that are never going to buy. I don't know why they fill out forms. They're just career form fillers, you know. Then there's a percentage that, like you're talking, pretty much anyone could help out. They're waiting. They're just waiting for you to give them the number.
Lay downs.
Yeah, like
they got. You just can't screw it up.
Right, you can't. It's right. Like as long as you give them something they can afford, like they're buying insurance.
They're buying.
You
it's just, already done. Just don't mess it up.
The only barrier is you, right?
You, don't screw it up.
But that's not the bulk of them.
No.
And there's, you know, where I think an agent becomes successful or unsuccessful is that other group that you do have to, you got to sell a little bit. You got to bring them back. And I even hate to use the word sell. I feel like it's more bringing them back to that emotion that they had when they first thought about this.
Sure, sure.
You know, how much of that, and I think we could kind of wrap with that, Alex, how much of that or where in your appointment does that happen where you bring them back to why they even filled this out in the first place?
Yeah, that's the most important. Yeah. So one of the things that I do is I take a full, I break down the mortgage, the value of the home, how much equity they have, what the home is going to be valued at in 10, 15 years, how much equity is going to have, they're going to have. Get down, break down their income. What does he make? What does she make? How much of that social, how much is that transferring to her or vice versa?
Mm-hmm.
What insurance policies? You got to get all that down because if you don't, they're going to come at you with something that you didn't know.
Sure.
And then now the sale's done.
Yep.
So you got to find all that information, how much insurance policies they have, what's it used for, how much retirement, what's that used for? Mm. Are you going to use your entire life savings and retirement to pay off the bank instead of having a policy do that? No. Okay. Breaking all that down. And then, you know, you analyze the numbers and you realize that they're short. One of them is gone.
Mm.
The person left behind is not enough. And you got to put them in the middle of that.
Yeah.
And you got to really walk them through that. So, Mary, let me ask you something. You know, I hate to do this to you, John, but I'm going to take you out of the picture for a second. Okay. John brings in $4,000. Okay. Your social is $1,300. His social replaces yours with X amount. You know, call it $1,800. Your bills are $3,000. He does not wake up tomorrow. What does your life look like? Or her income. Let's say they're younger.
Yeah.
Well, not good. Okay, what does that mean? Okay, so you wake up, he's no longer there. Keep in mind that the last check your house is going to get from him is the one before he passed. Mm. How long are you going to go in your home without that $4,000 check? Not very long. How long? It just happened.
Right.
Don't let it go. You got to keep asking. Okay, so what's going to happen in 2 months? Who's taking care of the kids? Oh, I'll have to get another job. Okay, realistically, are you going to be able to recuperate the $4,000? No. Who's taking care of the kids now that you're working 50 hours a week?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let me ask you a question, honestly. Does it make sense to have a policy in place to replace his income to make sure that you don't lose your home, you have food on the table, the lights are on, et cetera, in his absence? Yeah. Is that a luxury or is that a necessity? Oh, that's a necessity.
Mm.
Boom.
There you go.
Okay, let me show you what they said it. Doesn't it make sense to have a policy in place? Let me ask you something. Why would that be important to you? Now they got to come, not just yes, no, yes, no.
Right.
Well, it's important because if he's no longer here, at least the policy is going to be able to, now they just sold me.
Right.
They sold themselves. Now they're telling you why they need a policy.
Yeah.
You're not telling them.
Absolutely.
But you got to take them there without telling them to say that. You're taking them there. You're leading them there. 1 + 1 = 2. 1 + 2 = 3. What's 1 + 3? four. Without counting, they're going to say that.
Right.
So that's what you do with your questions.
That's huge.
Huge.
It's so big.
And then they tell you, and they're like, okay, let's see if we could get go ahead and take care right. of this.
And then what's great about that, too, is at any point in the appointment, if they get a little delusional and forget that, you're just bringing their words back up to them. Like, hey, Alex, remember you said that if you're not here, she's only going to last in this house for a month, and then she'll be out on the street. You said that to me.
You
so,
said it.
So if we don't do that, that's what's going to happen?
Sure.
You're okay with that? No, I'm not. Okay, cool. So like I said, it's going to be $89 a month. It's like
right.
you bring them back to that.
Right back to it. And also, you know, people buy insurance with money that's left over.
Mm-hmm.
No. Okay, your family is not at the bottom of the priority right. list. So that's what I do. So let me ask you a question. Again, and this is important to me, so I understand if this is of value to you, okay? How important is protecting your family in your absence? Very important. A scale of 1 to 10, how important is that? 10. Okay, so it's at the top of your priority list, right? So when I go through the numbers, I say, you know, affordability, this is key. Affordability is a matter of priority.
Right.
You have $5,000 coming in every single month. The things that are of most important to you are at the top of that list. Your family's at the top of the list, right? The things that are less important to you at the bottom of the list, those are the things you can't afford. So you have $5,000 going somewhere every month.
Right.
See, now you just brought them from down here to up here.
Yep.
Now, if it's not important to you, then it's not important to me. I'll close out your file.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's important to you, you know, now they can't say they can't afford it because you know their numbers.
Right. That's so huge. Last thing I want to point out about what you said, and I hope this is not missed, is when you're asking these questions and they don't give you full answers, you know, they're just like, is this important to you? Yeah, it is. Why? Oh, it just is. You're not moving on to the next one.
No.
And I think that people do move on to the next question because they're uncomfortable. Because they feel like that's confrontation almost,
sure.
right? Like,
sure.
You're giving me half answers. I know they're half answers, but like, let's just live in reality. You know it's a half answer. So ask him again.
Yeah.
What's the worst thing he's going to do? Give you the same half answer and then go, hey, dude, you just said that. Like, can you elaborate a little bit? Can you explain? You say it's important, but what does important mean to you?
What does that mean?
Just keep asking a question.
Yeah.
Ask another question. What's important mean to you? What are some other things that are important to you? Is this more important than that? Or like whatever, to just keep asking.
Sure, sure.
And eventually, if you stay here, I'm not getting upset like, I asked you a question, that ain't going to work,
right.
You know.
Yeah.
You didn't answer my question. Yeah, good luck with that. But if you can just stay here the whole time, and the person who asks more questions wins.
And they appreciate the fact that you're asking these questions
yes.
because you're evaluating their situation.
Right.
Very Absolutely. Different from just telling some. That's part of my why. I got sold insurance, life insurance.
Okay.
And when I got into the business, I realized, don't sell it. Evaluate it. Mm. Show them the need, and that's big difference. There's a different approach when you're selling
right.
than when you're trying to find what they need.
Yeah.
So it's that when you start taking the time to break down, look, when this happens and this happens, this is going to happen. This will take care of that need.
Mm-hmm.
Problem, solution. And then it goes, they could see that you're doing things a little bit different. And it goes beyond.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You gotta say, it's like they're in a boat and there's a leak. And you got to figure out, first of all, where the leak is, what's causing the leak, and then how do we fix it?
Yep.
And through that, what that looks like is, I'm painting the picture for them. Like when you're going through, here's your income, here's what you have, you're dead, here's what she has left over, here's how long would you be able to live there, right? What are you going to do when you don't have the 4K no more?
Sure.
That's painting that pitch because most people have not dealt, as much as they fill out the form and send it back, they've not dealt with this.
90% plus of the people that I speak to in their 50s, 60s, and 70s have no game plan from when
right.
the other person's gone.
Yep.
You have no idea how many people think, thank you, Alex, thank you mm-hmm. for doing this. Now we know that we're okay because of this really right. inexpensive plan that
sure.
they're putting
yeah,
in.
Yeah, and compared to what they're spending on everything else.
Oh,
like, God.
Very inexpensive. It usually ends up being like 5 to 10% of their income.
Sure.
Which is nothing.
Nope.
You know.
Especially for what you get with
yeah.
it, you know.
Without it, they're screwed.
Right. I mean,
with
we're talking
it,
death benefits change families for generations.
Yep.
Both sides, whether you have them or you don't.
Yep.
They impact families. Some families don't recover for generations after a breadwinner passes
sure.
away with no coverage.
But see, when you get to a point where you realize that you're helping somebody, you're not selling.
Right.
Because you're not just following the script. You're helping somebody. You're understanding the game.
Yeah.
And you're putting game plans together for these people.
Right.
And you're delivering your passion, the words, the emotions behind the words. They're done.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Well, that's awesome stuff. Good stuff. Before we wrap this up, this segment, I want to talk about this right here. What is this, Alex?
That is a micro cloth that cleans either your phone or your glasses or both.
Phone right here.
There you go.
Right, I can clean my glasses right here.
First thing,
this is yours.
Yep.
Your agency.
My company.
You leave these. How do you get these to the clients?
So once there's three things that I do. As soon as they you know, we write a policy, I send a thank you card that week. So it could be 2 or 3 days later.
Yeah.
It's got the same colors, everything.
Okay.
Thank you, business card inside. You know, we appreciate you letting us help you resolve your financial, you know, insurance needs and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
So they get that right away. So it's a little bit of a personal touch, right? Then about a week and a half to 2 weeks later, they get that in the mail. Okay. So that's because, you know, most of the cancellations happen your first month.
Right.
So this is basically helping, you know, buttering them up a little bit.
Sure.
It also shows that you care.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's just selling and getting a commission and moving on.
Right.
And so what I've learned is that if a policy could stay in the books for the first 3 to 4 months, usually 6 months, then there's like a 90% chance it's going to stay in the books. So most cancellations happen in the first 3 or 4 months.
Yeah.
So after the fiber cloth goes out, then the pen goes out.
We got this nice pen here.
Yeah.
Look at that. Pull it apart. It's a pen. It's a stylus, and it's got this little light on it.
Yep.
Look at that.
It's got my name on it, the name of the company, the phone number.
Yeah.
And that thing is just, that's quality. You could feel the weight on that everything.
Absolutely.
So altogether, I think including postage on all those things, I spend maybe $12.
$12 per client.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Compared to the how we get compensated.
Absolutely.
It's nothing.
It's nothing.
And my 6-month retention level is like 90%.
Wow.
So
persistency,
it goes between 89 and like 91.
Yeah,
that's, you know,
awesome,
so it works.
Yeah.
You know, so. And I tell them at the end, I said, look, just because we're not in contact every day talking to each other doesn't mean I'm not thinking about you.
Mm-hmm.
So from time to time, I'm going to reach out there in certain different ways, maybe something in the mail, just to let you know, hey, we're thinking about you. We're family. Just because we're not speaking doesn't mean I'm not here. And that's what that is.
That's great.
And they know that. So if there ever is an issue. Because I get people that say, look, someone's trying to do this and do that. Thank you for calling me. Let's sit down and evaluate it. I have a chance to save it versus just getting a replacement.
We talk about becoming their agent, becoming their guy, their girl, whatever the case may be. And this is one of the ways to do that.
Absolutely.
You meet with a lot of people. I mean, you said 10 to 12 a day, right?
Correct.
Or 10 to 12 appointments, meet with about half. You've helped over 500 families this year with life insurance.
Mm-hmm.
But doing little things like this, like now they know you from the initial call, right? I'm sure your booker tells them who they're going to speak to.
Uh-huh.
Then they meet you.
Uh-huh.
Then you send them a thank you card.
Yep.
Then you send them this micro cloth.
Right.
And then a pen. 5 different interactions with you. And actually only one of them was with you physically.
Right. Right.
And you don't think that when someone else calls them about insurance, they're going to go, oh no, I got that through Alex.
Yeah, I'm good.
They've only seen your name there 5 times in the past month and a half.
Goes a long way.
Yeah.
A lot of people make decisions not necessarily because it's better financially, but because of the connection and the comfort that they
Absolutely.
Have. Absolutely. I've gone to restaurants where the food may not be as great, but they treat me like I'm the most important person in the world.
Oh, yeah.
That's where I want to go.
Dude, I drive my family crazy. We go to like the same 4 places around here.
Because they treat you like a king.
Yeah,
they know who you are.
Yeah, we go to Long Shots up the road. My people
Boom.
Long Shots.
I got a Nino's. Table for you. There you go.
All the time. They only put my name in there, but I've been going there for years.
Yeah.
Food's great. Are there better? I'm sure I could go somewhere and get a better pizza. Sure, maybe. I don't know. Probably not. But I'm gonna go with no.
Yeah, and they treat me like a king.
Absolutely.
I come in here, I feel like I'm the man.
100%.
So that's who I'm going to.
100%.
And that's the same thing with that.
Love it. Well, thanks. Yeah. I appreciate you coming in.
My pleasure.
Appreciate you sharing this, guys. Thanks for joining. This was great. Check us out every week here inside the sale on TNL, and stay tuned. We got SRS training coming up. Don't miss that. We appreciate y'all joining.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining this morning's SRS segment of TNL. I have the annuity and IUL production numbers from the past week. Starting off on the annuity side, 42 policies issued for a total of $2.1 million. Those policies were placed by 35 unique writing agents. Very exciting for those 42 clients that now have their hard-earned retirement money protected from market loss. Switching over to the IUL side, a total of 1,859 families received protection with an IUL for a total of $2.6 million. Again, very exciting for those clients who now have access to all the benefits of an IUL. Alrighty, please reach out to us if you need help getting your pending business pushed through and placed on the books. We would love to help you. Or if you would like to know how to add annuities and IULs to your business, please reach out to us. You can email info@fflams.com. Alrighty, stay tuned for an annuity interview up next with SRS Director Bridget Reimer and Coronado Haro.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us on this week's SRS segment on the TNL. Bridget Reimer, Director of Family First Life SRS Division here with Coronado Haro this morning. Coronado, thank you so much for joining me.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Yes, of course. And you were out there in California, is that right?
That is correct.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, you've been around for a while, but I lose track of time. So tell me and remind me again when you got started with Family First Life.
I've been here roughly 2.5 years, maybe just over that, something like that.
Okay. Yeah. That's that. It's crazy how fast time goes, right?
Yeah. And so, I think the last time I saw you was over in Arizona, and that was
is that 2 years ago?
No, I think it was last winter or.
Oh, okay. Yeah. In Phoenix. Yep.
Yeah, in Mesa. Uh-huh.
Yep. So yeah, been almost a year then.
Tempe.
Yes, Tempe. Well, it's good to see you virtually again and hopefully in person soon. But again, thank you for hopping on. I'm excited to hear what you have to share with our agents. And so Coronado, today I just want you to talk through your process, specifically in regards to annuities, but I know you do a lot of IUL and annuity volume. And so really what we're trying to accomplish is getting the agents perspective out there on how simple the products are, how you prospect the opportunity with your clients. And so we're just going to go through a little bit of your sales process today. My first question or item I want you to speak on is tell me how you prospect or identify an opportunity with the clients that you're sitting with.
So every time I do a lot of my appointments in-house, I'm a kind of a face-to-face type person. Mm-hmm. And when I'm sitting down with my clients, if I happen to be there for life insurance, that is what I basically focus on 100% in the beginning. Mm-hmm. So as I'm sitting down with them, I'm identifying, the carrier, their medications, the coverage and so forth. But what I start to do is I start to plant little seeds along the way. And as you know, as I'm running a quote, you know, sometimes the software takes a little bit to load or what have you on the computer. I say, you know, by the way, we also specialize in, simple retirement solutions. What do you got going on for retirement? Mm-hmm. And then I'll have them say, oh, I have a 401k at my job, or I have an IRA, what have you. Like, oh, okay, cool. You know, and then I kind of just do a little bit of this. If you see my hands, mm-hmm. I focus on this, and then kind of just a little, you know, like a little jab or, you know, plant a little seed, and I come back to my focus. So I'm starting to, gain information as to what they might be having going on for retirement. Mm-hmm. And then after my presentation, you know, whether I close or I don't, I come back and say, well, you know what? Remember, I mentioned in the beginning that that we specialize in basically protecting people's retirements. You know, we do have some programs out there that would actually guarantee your money from any stock market losses. If you have a 401k or you have an IRA or you have any other type of program out there, there's a ton of them, CalPERS and, you have CalSTRS and programs like that, or even stocks or even mutual funds. So we do have programs that guarantee your money from losses with the potential of double digit returns. Maybe when we get back together, I can go a little bit more into detail on that. Mm-hmm. And then that's pretty much how I start to pique their interest. But if I'm there for life insurance, I handle that aspect first. I don't just dive in. Even if they have $500K and a 401K, yeah, and I'm going to write a $50 Aetna policy, I'm going to write the Aetna policy first and then basically, do a second appointment.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, and I love that. Like you're there to help them with what they asked for, right? And there's no better way to throw off a client, I feel, than going in and attempting to help them with what they want and then taking it totally left field, right? And changing gears on them entirely. Yeah. So I like the idea of planting seeds and filling your time, you know, hey, also we do this just so you know, right? Because that's you representing yourself with the full capacity of your license, right? And we try to teach agents that you have the power to help protect human capital and financial capital, right? Human capital with life insurance, financial capital with IULs and annuities, and you're licensed to do so. So why not represent yourself that way?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So from there, then I heard you say kind of just the one-liner, really, like, hey, we have programs that can help protect you from market loss. So you're really honing in on one major benefit of the FIA and piquing their interest with that. You're not trying to present all the features and benefits in that piquing interest. You're not even necessarily saying, hey, I have an annuity. Do you want to see it? You're saying I have a program. I love that. I have a program that helps protect from market loss, and you just gauge their interest. Yeah. If they say yes, in our next meetup, I'd love to see more. What do you do from there?
If I happen to come back a second time, which I have a very high, my percentage is pretty high as far as coming back. So when I come back, I say, well, you know what, let's get into this, secondary conversation that we previously discussed. Would you mind if I ask you, what is it you have going on for retirement? Oh, you know, I have a 401k. The first thing I'm going to ask is, well, do you still currently work with that employer? Right. If they say, yes, I do. If I'm there for final expense, they're at least 50 plus, right? So there are some laws in California that allow you to be able to move money over while they're still at their employer. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be a good point for me to touch on. But if they tell me, you know what? It's actually from my previous company. I mean, for me, that's like ding, 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 ding.
Yep.
That's like a go. So what I'll say, okay, well, so let me explain this product that I'm talking to you about that gives you the, 100% guarantee of no losses. There's actually additional bonuses. I'm in a position right now to put you in a program that could potentially earn you double-digit returns. We're talking 10% or above. It's not a guarantee, but these programs perform very well. I mean, even if you're earning, a 7% rate of return, if you understand the rule of 72 and compound interest, over a 10-year time frame, your money could actually double in 7 years. Mm-hmm. With a 10% rate of return, or it could actually vary somewhere along there. I also mentioned to them, potentially whatever you have there, it's bonusable. So we do have a program with one of our prime carriers that offers a bonus. This plan is established strictly for growth. So there is a bonus program out there that I could introduce you to. It comes at no cost to you. There's pros and cons to this program. You know, I've already explained to you, you can potentially get a bonus. You can get some potentially double digit returns. And then also the market fluctuation will protect you from any losses. So the give and take, there's a give and take to everything. In this particular case, maybe you might want to, what you're going to have to basically understand is that you're going to hold on to this program anywhere from 7 to 10 years. So you get all the goodies, but at the same time, if you understand, specifically if you're 50 or 52 or 55, typically retirement is not till 65. If you're willing to hold on to this program between 7 and 10 years, then I think this would be a great fit for you. Mm-hmm. And then I'll run an illustration and kind of show them the numbers from there.
Yeah. So you're really kind of outlining all the benefits, showing them the drawbacks, which, sure. 7 to 10 years is the surrender period that you're referring to.
Correct.
Hey, this is a long-term contract. Would you like to see what that looks like? Right.
Exactly.
And so talk to me a little bit about, before you knew, before you were equipped to run illustrations on your own in the home, what did you do to be confident in the products that you were about to represent? And what resources maybe did you tap into to learn about what products are out there so that you knew what to show your clients?
Well, you know what, at the end of the day, I used to have, I'm actually still licensed. I've been real estate licensed for 24 years, but even back in the day, I figured if I'm going to go out there and get a state license, I'm going to educate myself and I'm going to want to dig and research as much as I can so I can understand my craft. Mm-hmm. Every carrier has a sales department that you can call for free. I don't always depend on my, the people that brought me into the business. You know, in our industry, it's called an upline. Mm-hmm. They've got other things that they got going on. So if it's a quick question or quick text or whatever, I do contact my upline. Mm-hmm. But I took personal responsibility for my business. And I said, you know what, I'm going to educate myself. And I'm not going to ask a sideline or potentially even a downline or an upline. I'm going to call the carrier and get facts because I've been in this industry long enough where everybody thinks that they know, but they're not 100% certain. Mm-hmm. So I would rather call, in this case, like the Athene sales department. They're very helpful. They can answer my questions. I read over brochures. I look at the surrender schedules and everything. And then I empower myself with these brochures of these particular products. And then I email them to my clients so they can, they can attach a name to the actual product. And then, Athena is very highly ranked across the nation. So that's what I do. I just took personal accountability to, I understood that I was going to make some mistakes initially. Mm-hmm. And so I don't think that failure is failure. I think failure is just a way for you to just improve and just get better at your craft.
Yeah. I love how you put that. Like, look, if I'm going to go get a license, like that's how I'm representing myself. So I want to be good at it. It's just like any job. If you're going to go get a job, you better be investing at doing a good job to keep receiving the paycheck. Right. If we're going to go be in real estate, we want to be a good real estate agent. So like anything that takes time and investment on ourselves, right? Especially in that self-employed world, you have to choose to invest in yourself. And so that's not a bad thing. Everybody has a little bit of time in their day to learn something, right? Like, and I love that you use the product brochures. I think those are overlooked sometimes, but really they're a great snapshot of the product.
Yeah.
Like you pull up a product brochure, it tells all the major key points and benefits. It's easy to understand and read. It doesn't go deep into the weeds, right? I think that's probably an underutilized resource that carriers have available. And you're right. We work with some fantastic carrier partners whose sales desk are more than willing to help answer any questions.
You know, what I've learned over time is that so long as people get the brochure, I'm being very transparent with them. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they're kind of just going to page through it. They're not going to read every line, but the fact that you sent them something with the name of the company and then, how the company's rated and it has like the name of the product and everything. No one that I've talked to, at least to this point, has actually read that thing line by line and fine print and everything. I think once you send that to them, they feel a little bit more comfortable because it's something that they can actually hold on to and have in their possession.
Yeah. It's tangible. It makes it real. Like, okay, this is a real company that he's talking about, not just something that's made up. So it gives them maybe some security. And I love that you say you have yet to run into a client that reads it line by line because you've been doing this a long time. I mean, I know you have experience in the industry prior to FFL.
Sure.
And so you've sat with enough clients and the truth is most clients don't go that deep. No. Yeah. Well, that's awesome. So you pique their interest, you come back, you kind of highlight the key benefits. You're not getting crazy talking about indexing or purchasing options or how the companies make money or anything like that. You point out the things that are important to the client, what benefits the client. I like that you put in the cons because everything can appear to be too good to be true. So we want to make sure that there's something there that makes it not one of those gimmicky experiences, right? And then you run the illustration and you weren't afraid to dive in and do the research and take pride in what you're representing.
You know, I think it's important for people to know that in a lot of cases, less is more. You don't want to have diarrhea of the mouth and, you don't want to give too much because if you give out too much, that's just going to cause for the client to just be curious and they're going to start to bombard you with questions. I learned a long time ago, the person asking the questions is in control. Like when a cop pulls you over, he's in control because he's asking you questions, right? Mm-hmm. So what I do is I like to keep things very simple. I keep it very ABC. And when I do that, I feel that I have a little bit more control of the appointment. I'm really there to benefit the client. I don't want to confuse them. I want to just get them excited and educate them up to a certain point.
Yeah, absolutely. That's fantastic. And that is it, being good at controlling the appointment and setting the stage. And then if you've done it right, you're not leaving a whole ton of room for questions.
Correct.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. Any last tips that you would share with an agent, either new or old, who maybe isn't utilizing their whole license by incorporating annuities into their business?
Right. I mean, I do have a couple of tips. You know, something that I learned early on. You know, there's a thing out there called the baby boomer generation. And between 1946 and 1964, during that 18-year time frame, there were roughly 71.6 million people born. Mm-hmm. Guess what? Those people today are retiring. Mm-hmm. So if we really want to target this baby boomer generation, which has trillions of dollars out there floating around that we can actually manage and transfer and help these people out, I think it's very important for people to understand the era that we're in right now. Mm-hmm. Because if you're already dealing, I just think we can just basically combine both. If you're there to sit down with a person who's 50 plus to offer them a final expense product, those people are more than likely baby boomers. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's roughly 10,000 baby boomers who turn retirement age daily, right? Mm-hmm. In the country. Mm-hmm. And there's a whole lot of them in California. So, you know, I don't do annuities in many states, but I have enough here. I shouldn't say I have enough. I'd be a, you know, millionaire at this point, but I have plenty of business here in California. And I think that, you know, just understanding that if the company's model is final expense, we're talking about seniors, and a lot of these seniors are going to need help with whatever retirement they have. So I think that if you just take your mind there and you ask those questions, either in the beginning, through the middle of your appointment, and at the end, I certainly believe that you can come back for a second appointment and handle those needs for those clients.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. We're in a huge opportunity era right now. That combined with the volatility of the market and what we're seeing is the perfect storm. And I like that you pointed out the number. There's trillions of dollars out there floating around that a lot of those people don't know what to do with, right? Mm-hmm. And we have a fantastic solution in the FIA. You're helping the client. You're putting them in the best scenario possible. You're taking away all the risk. Why we're doing a disservice if we're not offering our clients these products.
Absolutely.
And you're missing an opportunity as an agent, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Absolutely. Well, I appreciate that. Thanks for pointing that out, because that is huge. The time is now, and we keep saying that, but combining those two aspects together, the opportunity is massive. So, well, thank you, Coronado. I really appreciate you sharing with us today. Look forward to seeing you again soon and seeing how you wrap up the year.
Awesome. It was my pleasure.
Okay. Take care, everybody. We'll see you next week.
Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.
All right, everyone. Thanks for watching. Next week on Tuesday, we have True Talk with Alex Valencia. Alex talks about his transition from stock and commodities into life insurance and his struggles early on. And on Friday, we're back with the Next Level Live and Valentino Kali talking about selling with passion and how it is an important aspect to your business foundation. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe so you don't miss out. See you all next week.